of people from all over the world joining this webinar. So, well, who is in this webinar a little bit later than 8 o'clock, you're very welcome to join the webinar. And, well, compliments to you all that you are in the second part of the webinar, that you're still here. And I hope you can understand my Dunglish. I saw you were talking about it. I have a little bit of mix of Dutch and English, but well, it's about the message, let's say it like that, that I bring a message, and sometimes it's a little bit in Dunglish. We spoke about the natural asymmetry, now we are going to the straightness training. And what is straightness training? Straightness training is nothing more, nothing less than rebalancing the horse on all the 8 subjects we were talking about before the break. And the end result will be symmetry in body and limbs. So let's have a look at those 6 steps or 6 keys, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, perhaps steps is not such a good idea because sometimes you do them all together at the same time, or 1, 2, 3 together at the same time or something like it. But well, I just for your overview, I made those 6 steps. So let's go to the first step. And the first step is the lateral bending. And the left horse is a left-banded horse. And this horse has to learn to bend to the right. And then, the green arrows, the horse has to shorten the green side. So he has to shorten the green short muscles, and he has to lengthen the red arrows. So the red side of the horse, he has to stretch those sides. And well, that takes a while because we have to deal with ligaments and tendons, seas and muscles, and the spine is involved, and the horse is of course not movable in every part of the spine. The neck is very movable, of course, but the part with the chest vertebrae, especially the first 8 pairs of ribs, these are connected to the bottom with the sternum, so that's not movable so much. It's a very stiff part of the horse. And the lumbar vertebrae behind the saddle, this part is after the neck vertebrae, is the most movable. And of course the croup, where the pelvis is, in that area, those vertebrae are connected together to the sacrum, so that's also a very stiff part. And although we think the horse can bend from head to tail to both sides, because of the spine and how the spine is working with all its vertebrae, the flexibility will differ in the different areas. Well, and we have the spine that is necessary for the lateral bending, but we also need the muscles, and a very important muscle we have to stretch is the long back muscle, and there's a difficult name for it, longissimus dorsi, that is the Latin name, and that's a very, very important muscle we have to stretch. And that's that muscle is really a long muscle. It starts with the neck vertebrae, and it's located on both sides of the spine. And well, that muscle on both sides has to learn to contract to both sides and to stretch to both sides. And well, that's part number one. So you see that I'm not starting with making the head of the horse in a nice position, because a lot of riders think, oh, if the head of the horse is in a good position, then everything will turn out right. So they do like this with their hands, and then the horse is walking like this. But that has nothing to do with training of the muscles. And you have to figure out that when I shorten my, I don't know what this is called, but when I shorten this, my arm is going up. And when I relax this, my arm is going down. And if this is the back of the horse, when the horse will stiffen its back, the head goes up. And when the horse will stretch his back, the head will go down. And if we stretch the long back muscles from the left to the right, from the left to the right, then the back muscles will stretch, so the head will come in a forward down position. And that's the second key of straightness training, the forward down. When the horse will come in a forward down position, the back will go up. That is some mechanism in the horse that will automatically occur. And then you see that the end of the vertebrae, especially with the near the wither, that there is some space. And when the horse, his head will go up, that could result in kissing spines. And that is the end of the vertebrae will kiss each other, and that hurts. And then the horse start bucking and things like that. But if a horse will carry you in a forward down position, you will not have to be afraid of things like kissing spines. So this is the second key. The horse will have to walk in forward down, and this is almost an automatical result of key one, the lateral bending. And then we have step three, or key number three, that because of the lateral bending and the forward down position of the head, the horse will step under with the inside hind leg. Because the horse will stretch to both sides, the inside hip will come forward. And because of the inside hip that will come forward, he is able to step under the correct point of weight. So we don't want to have the center of mass to the left or to the right front leg, but we want to have it under the rider in the beginning. And after a while, we want to have those red spots more and more to the hind legs. But because of the lateral bending to both sides, the forward down and the stepping under, we want to achieve that the red ball will be in the middle, and that the inside hind leg will step under the point of weight. And this is a very important exercise to equal the hind legs. We know there's a pushing hind leg and a carrying hind leg, so especially the pushing hind leg has to find this point of weight. The three steps, it's lateral bending, forward down, and stepping under, I will also call the LFS. You can see that the horse is in the bending, in the forward down position, and it will step under with the inside hind leg. These three keys, if you do only that in your life with your horse, you will have much more benefit. Your horse will more benefit from it, and your horse will remain much more sane. He will have a supple body. He will find his point of weight with the hind legs. He will be in a forward down position, so he has a relaxed back. And if you should only do this, it will make a marvelous difference. And it saves you from a lot of problems I mentioned before. And now you want to know, of course, how can I do this LFS? So I will show you. Well, the first thing is work in hand. And we do not are very familiar with this. A lot of us only ride a horse and a little bit launching, of course. But if a horse is in very much imbalance, and then it's not a good idea that he has to learn this kind of things, just the lateral bending and the forward down and stepping under, when we are on top of him. Because if he cannot carry himself correctly, then it's more difficult that he has to carry, to find his good position in his body with us on top. So with very asymmetrical horses, I start with work in hand. And I use, what you can see here, is a cavesson. Because I mentioned before, the horse will be stiff in the mouth on one side, but that's not a problem, that's a symptom. So it doesn't, it's not a good idea to correct him a lot in his mouth. And I will tell you about this a little bit. The mouth of a horse makes the feeling of something 8 times bigger than when you look at it. And when you see a child, a young child, he put everything in his mouth. And he discovers the world through his mouth. And his mother is very angry, don't put it in your mouth because it's dirty. But the child is discovering the world with his mouth because, yeah, it gives so much information, 8 times more than when you see it. So when you communicate with a horse with a bit, it's huge for a horse, all the information you are giving. And you want to have him react very quickly on the bit. But if you have to correct him in his muscles because he is stiff and he's asymmetrical and things like that, then it's not a good period in his life to use a bit. And I think it's a good thing to use the nose, because the nose gives one-on-one information. Of course you can jerk on the nose, and that's not nice easy either, but we don't jerk, of course, in the straightness training. But the information will be one-on-one, and yeah, if he is stiff, you can ask a little bit that he will stretch without disturbing the mouth. That's the reason why we use the cavesson. We have different types of cavessons. I use this one, it's not too big, it's easy, light and simple. So that's how I start with work in hand. And then when he has learned the LFS in hand, then you can start launching. And exactly on the launch, he can walk, trot and canter. And you have to be careful that he will be in the lateral bending, that he will stretch forward down, and that he will step under with the point of weight. And the point of weight is the red dot, and I made the red dot a little bit too small. It's much bigger, actually. It's a big red ball in the body of the horse. And of course, when the horse can do it on the ground and on the launch, we start riding. And especially the circles and the serpentines and the S shape exercises are very good for a horse to create the correct LFS. And of course the serpentine is very difficult because you have to be careful that the horse will not fall on the inside shoulder or fall out through the outside shoulder. So it's a very balancing exercises. And but this will go very easier with riding if you did work in hand first and launching first. With young horses, it's a good thing that when you start riding that you have the launcher on the ground to help the horse to find his balance. It's just horse riding is nothing more, nothing less than rebalancing and rebalancing and rebalancing again. And it's because it's balance in movement, and the point of weight is shifting, because if a horse in one step push too much, then the point of weight, center of mass, will shift. So you have to rebalance again. And it's therefore we use also the half halt, but that I will talk later about in another webinar or something. But the half halt, that's also a mystery and a secret. And what is a half halt? But the half halt, the purpose of a real half halt, it's not only just jerking and do this in the reins. No, it's rebalancing the horse. And when you feel that the point of weight is going to the left front legs, that you bring it back under you, and that you say to the hind leg, come under the point of weight. And it's a system of rebalancing. So you give, for example, in one training session, 845 half halts. But it's huge, it's a lot. At the Spanish riding school, they say, we make 4 half halts at a circle. And so we divide the circle in 4. We have 4 quarters in a circle, and every quarter we rebalance the horse, riding the half a quarter, rebalance again, next half quarter, and then the horse remains in balance during the whole circle. So rebalancing is really the magic word. All right, we continue with the next steps. Oh yeah, and if the horse can do the LFS on the circle, that's where we start, then it's important to also have the LFS on the straight line. Because what we discovered is that the shoulders are much smaller than the hind legs, the hips. So you have to walk in a kind of shoulder four, or plié, as Gustav Steinreich, the great grandmaster of the 19th century, said. He called it a plié. We have to walk in the riding arena always in a kind of plié, because if we don't do that, then the inside hind leg is nowhere. The inside hind leg is somewhere next to the horse, so it never can take weight from the front legs. And we want that. So we need that the inside hind leg will always find the point of weight and will never walk next to the horse. Okay, then we go over to step 4, to key number 4. And if we have reached the lateral bending, the forward down and the stepping under, then we can put more weight on the inside hind leg. And because we put more weight on this inside hind leg, the inside hind leg can bend in all those 7 joints. If the horse will not bend in those areas, then you will have a very stiff hind leg. And for the all the joints have names, but okay, it's important, but also not that important. But you have the upper joint is the sacroiliac. I wrote it down because the English terms are a little bit different. Then you have the hip joint, and then the stifle joint, the hock joint, the fetlock joint, the pastern joint, and the coffin joint. Well, the most important joints is the lumbosacral joint. It's the one on near to the croup, and the hip joint, and the stifle joint, the joint where the knee is. And these three joints has to bend more. And also the hock joint must bend, but that hock joint has not so much muscles around itself, so that's easier to bend than those joints in the buttock. But that's the real thing in horse riding, to make these hind legs more bendable, and it's an important job and not that easy. Because you will need the stiff hind leg from your horse. But what is the exercise to accomplish this? That is the exercise shoulder in. So what we will do in the shoulder in is we put the center of mass in the direction that the hind leg will step forward. So the hind leg will step forward and will meet this center of mass. And because he will step under this point of weight, he has to carry that weight for a while. If we do this exercise on a straight line, then he will have to carry this weight on the for a while. You have to put it this way. If you and I go to the gym, then we have some nice dumbbells, and we can do 10 times like this and 10 times like this, and do things like this and like this, and then this will grow and this will grow, and we will get muscles. But we cannot give a dumbbell to a horse and say, well, horse, just do this a few times and then you will be strong. So we cannot give him weight. What we can do is put his own weight on the hind leg. And because we put his weight on the hind leg, how should I do it? Then we can, we do something like this. We can also do such an exercise. And then we become very tired. So do that exercise, then you can imagine what it is like for a horse to do the push-ups. It's like a kind of push-up for a horse. So you bring his weight to his hind leg, and the hind leg has to do like this. And when you are going on a straight line in the shoulder in, then for example, that are 10 steps with the inside hind leg, then the inside hind leg is doing 1, 2, 3, 10 on the straight line, and that's the gymnastic exercise. So the shouldering is really, really, really so very much important exercise, and they call it also the queen of exercises, or the mother of all exercises, or like Nuno Oliveira called it, the aspirin of the dressage, because it cured everything. And if you he has a point there, but because it cured the pushing hind leg, it cured the bending to the left, to the right, because in shouldering to the right the horse has to bend to the right, and the shouldering to the left the horse has to bend to the left. It gives the horse more shoulder freedom, because the legs are working in diagonals, and when the inside hind leg is carrying weight, the outside front leg will have more freedom. So the point of weight is going backwards, and the horse will lighten his shoulders. And that's what we want. So first the LFS, the three things are very important, and then the shoulder in. So also the shoulder in for your Icelandic horse, your Friesian, your cold blood trotter, your, I don't know, we have such a range of different horses in sizes, or also your pony, your Shetland pony. it will also, if you have a Shetland pony which is in front of a couch, he will be much easier go to the left, to the right in front of your carriage or your couch, if he is more bendable, and if he reaches his hind legs better. And also if you have, for example, the English country is a hunting country and it has some seasons. So in the seasons, the horses will have to hunt and run and be fast. But if the rider should, in between those hunting seasons, do the straightness training with the LFS and the shoulder in, then the horses should be much more supple in the next season. And the horses, yeah, were strong and fit and phew, and they could jump and more easy. So it's the straightness training is not only for dressage horses, not at all. It's for horses in front of a couch, it's for hunting horses, but it's really supporting gymnastic exercises, and it's good for every size and every race. And it keeps the horse strong and healthy. So that's the fourth step, the shoulder in. Here I have picture of it, that the goal from the shoulder in is that the horse will have more shoulder freedom. And that's really, really important. And I'm looking here on the picture in the mirror, but you should not do that because your head is about 7 kilos or something. It is a lot of weight, your head. And the more brains you have, the more the heavier it is. I don't know, I'm just saying something. But your head has to be in the direction of the horse, because if you do like this, then your upper body is also doing like this a lot of times. And then you're shifting the weight, and then the horse will be not in balance anymore because of you. So it's also, if you want to have the horse light in the front legs and you do like this, because we are all looking to the horse, if he is nice, in a nice shape and round, then you bring your weight on the front legs. So head up, when you want to look down, you can also look down with your eyes like this. You don't have to do like this. So that's an exercise for tomorrow when you are riding. Just be aware, what are you doing with riding? Are you riding like this? Or then you can change your riding with also only look like this. But better is to feel and not watch. If you watch too much down, then you don't feel. But that's another story. And I have a lot of stories, but not this evening. All right. I make every month these kind of stories in the home study course straightness training. But tonight we are talking about the four keys, the six keys. So let's go over to the fifth key. I don't repeat that. and that's the bending of the outside hind leg. And we use for this exercise the so-called quarter in. And also this exercise we can learn the horse on the ground, because it's not that simple to the difficult side for a horse to find the point of weight, the center of mass, with the outside hind leg. And but we can teach him that from the ground, and it takes a little bit too much details to explain how you can do it, But you can teach the horse that from the ground, and after a while you can learn it also from above. And why is this such an important exercise? Because the outside hind leg is stepping in a direction, and it's stepping in the direction that he will meet the point of weight. So he will step under the point of weight, and then he has to carry this weight for a while with the outside hind leg. So we did first the inside hind leg, and this exercise is doing the outside hind leg, simply said. But because it takes a little bit different coordination in his body, because in the shouldering, the inside hind leg will cross over the outside hind leg, and in the quartering, the outside hind leg will cross over the inside hind leg. So it's a little, there's a slight difference in coordination, and so it will also use other muscles. So it's also a very important exercise. And not because you have to use it in some kind of competition level. So you reach that level, oh, now let's start with the quartering because the judge wants to see it. Why do you do the quartering? I don't know, but the judge wants to see it. All right. So that's not a good idea, that you do exercises and that you don't know why. Or you think you know why, because the why is because of the judge want to see it. But the why is for a shouldering, because I want to bend the inside hind leg and to make the outside front leg more free. Or the quartering in you use because you want to bend the outside hind leg. And you have to think this when you are doing the exercises, because horses feel the direction of your thinking. If you think something, then energy is rolling. I'm sure that you know that when you think on the canter, the horse is starting cantering. That happens a lot of times. So your thoughts are also very important. So when you're not thinking with an exercise, you have not an inner vision and an inner picture, and you don't know why you do something, then you end up with a caricature or a lookalike. That's easier for me to pronounce. Then you have a lookalike exercise, and the world is full of lookalike exercises, because I'm sure you know shoulderings that are straight, that the hind legs is stepping behind the point of weight, and the horse is very spectacular, but he's not carrying the weight. So, but the judge loves it because it's so spectacular. But it has nothing to do with making the inside hind leg more bendable. So you have to first think and then do it. And if you have a clear plan, clear vision, and you know what you're talking about, and with your Icelandic horse, you know, all right, haunches in, quarter in is very important for my Icelandic horse. And you don't have to ride competition to do those exercises. I hope that everybody will do these exercises. Okay, let's have a look, quick look at the shouldering and the quartering, the relation between the two of them. You see, both exercises need the LFS, the lateral bending, the forward down and stepping under. And with the shouldering, the inside hind leg is stepping under the point of weight, and with the haunches in, the outside hind leg is stepping to the point of weight. That's of course not completely true, because in a shouldering we also need support from the outside hind leg, because the horse doesn't walk on three legs in the shouldering. So the outside hind leg must not go away from the body. And also in the haunches in, we need also an inside hind leg to the point of weight. But that makes it a little bit complicated perhaps. So just remember in the first place, okay, the inside hind leg is the main purpose of the shoulder in, and the outside hind leg is the main purpose of the haunches in. Okay, and then we have, when the horse has learned the haunches in, you can make some variations on it. Just for example, when you put the wall to the other side, then when you see the picture on the left, it's called the haunches in, and or travers, we say in Holland. And on the right picture, because of the wall is on the other side, it's called the renvers. And that's a good switch to make, because then the horse has not so much support anymore of the wall. So that's a good exercise to make it a little bit more difficult for the horse. And François de la Gurinière, that was a great grandmaster in the 18th century, he was not fan of the travers, the quartering, because a right-banded horse has from by nature a little bit a quarter in kind of walk. So that horse could easily fall back in his old failures, because he's falling then on the left shoulder hanging on the wall. So if you have a right-banded horse, it's better idea to do the renvers. Oh, I hope you can follow every left, right. Nou ja. Okay, but that's a little bit the idea behind it. That the renvers, then the horse has to be a little bit more on his own feet. And the half pass is exactly the same as a quartering or a renvers, but the horse has no wall anymore. You bring the horse in a quarter in kind of movement on the diagonal of the riding arena, and it starts, you can see it here to make it even more complicated, it starts with a shoulder in, because the shoulders has to be leading, because the point of weight, you have to make the point of weight that the hind legs can reach that point of weight. And here in the half pass, then the right hind leg has to step to the point of weight, and then the left hind leg has to step to the point of weight. So you see, this is a quartering on a diagonal, and both hind legs must find the point of weight. Of course, you can go sidewards and have the bending to the other side, but then the hind legs don't find the point of weight. So the half pass is really, you have the bending to the right, the inside hip is coming forward, the shoulders are leading, because here's the big ball with the weight, and the ball is going like that on the diagonal, and the inside hind leg is stepping under, and the outside hind leg, and the inside hind leg. And when the shoulders are not leading and the horse is going to that direction, then the hind leg steps in nothing. So then it's not a half pass anymore. Then it's spectacular, of course. You can have big movements and the judge will give you a high number. But it has nothing to do with the exercising that you want to make the hind legs more strong. So in the half pass, start always with the shoulder in, and then with your quartering aid, you can go on the diagonal. Okay, and then when the horse has learned all these kind of things, then we have key number six, and that's bending of both hind legs. And because of all the other keys, the horse is stronger and stronger, and at some level he will give you the feeling that he is up to it, that he can do this key, that he can bend both hind legs. And there we use the piaf in the trot. And the piaf is kind of trot on the place. And there he is lowering his hindquarters. He's lifting his front legs. He is a more uphill walking. And that's the piaf. And then we have for the canter, the pirouette. And the pirouette is nothing else than quartering on a circle. And you make the quarter in on the circle, you make the circle very small. It's really not so difficult. Horse riding and training horses is not so difficult. Yes, it is. But the thought, if you know what you are doing, if you know on which track you are, then it's much easier. If you just go to your horse and think, oh, I have to train 1 hour. I give my horse 1 hour walk, trot and canter, and that's the training. But that's not the training. Then the horse has learned nothing, and when he was moving in his natural asymmetry, he is after 1 hour still moving in that natural asymmetry. But when you go to the riding arena, you have to think, okay, what am I going to do? What is my goal? What do I want to reach? I want to reach a healthy horse that lives a long time. I hope my horse will be 30, even older. The main age in Holland with our dressage competition horses is 7 years old. That's nothing, because a horse is mature when he's 8 years, then he's a grown-up. So a lot of horses never reach their grown-up age, because then they're destroyed or mentally nervous or lame or back problems, all kind of stuff. So that's not what we work for, because our horses are our friends and we love them and we want to have them healthy, and we will want to have a long life with them, and we want to sit on them. So it's our duty that to make the conditions like that, that he can carry us good and soft and strong and in a good way. So we use the piaf to reach that goal. For us, the piaf is not a goal, it's a mean, it's a tool. The shoulder in the quarter in the canter pirouette, that are not the goals, that are the tools. And of course, the tools are very beautiful if the horse can do those exercises, and if the horse can do the exercises very well, then it's beautiful to watch. Then it's also a piece of art. And what's beautiful to watch is beautiful most of the time. Because if you see a ballet dancer and it's very crooked, then you don't like to watch the ballet show, I think. But if it's very elegant and very nice, or you should have to know how hard work it is for a ballet dancer to make such a pretty performance. But those it looks then very beautiful. And of course, also in the ballet world, when you put the word too much for everything, then it's not good at all, of course. But if you give your horse good exercises, like I mentioned before, then you will set up the good conditions for your horse. Well, then one last thing that I will then you know a lot of the track of straightness training, and that's this exercise. It's not that you have to strive for it, but here you see 100% of the weight of a horse on the hind legs. And you have to keep that in mind when you are doing the shouldering, the quartering and the piaf, that you working towards this kind of balance, as much weight as possible to the hind quarters. And that inner vision, and that's important that you keep that in mind, that you are busy working, shifting the weight. The fragile front legs who cannot bend so much as the hind leg, you have to be careful with those front legs. The front legs and the back of the horse are two things we need to prevent from problems. Alright, that was straightness training for this evening. And let me show you this thing. Here you see a quote from Michelangelo. And he says, every block of stone has a statue inside it, and it's the task of the sculptor to discover it. So he says, I'm not making a statue, it's already in it. And that's with our horses. We don't have to produce everything on our horses. It's already in it. But we have to know how we can discover it. And that's where straightness training will help you.